Well, good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the 18th meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2022. The first item on our agenda for committee members is to agree to take agenda items 3 and 4 in private. Are we all agreed? Agreed. We are agreed, thank you. The principal agenda item we've got this morning is continued consideration of the Auditor General for Scotland report, new vessels for the Clyde and Hebrides, arrangements to deliver vessels 801 and 802. And can I welcome our witness this morning, Jim McCall, the former director of Ferguson Marine Engineering Limited. You're welcome, Mr. McCall. And we had also hoped to take evidence this morning from the former Chief Executive Officer of FML, Jerry Marshall. Unfortunately, he's not now available, but as always, the option remains open to the committee to consider whether we wish to seek further evidence at a future date. Mr. McCall, we've got a written submission from you, so thank you for that. But I would now like to invite you to make a short around 2 minute opening statement before we get into questions.
Right, okay. Well, you know, first, thank you very much for the opportunity to be here today to participate in the process. You know, I was also happy to participate in the RECC inquiry and the recent Audit Scotland review. Myself and the former senior management team have put forward a lot of factual evidence to assist these processes. In both cases, however, we felt it necessary to submit responses to both reports due to our concern that important issues were either not addressed, were factually inaccurate, or had been presented in a way that was misleading. There are four main factors which have caused the massive cost overruns and extensive delays, in our view. One is the wrong type of vessels were selected. Two is insufficient development of the specification prior to the placing of the order. The third factor is shutting down all opportunities during this build process for dispute resolution. And fourth, the nationalisation and the steps that have been taken since then have been catastrophic. And I'm happy to expand on those later on if you would allow that. You know, I think it's been damaging what's happened to the reputation of the leadership team, our team and the workforce, and there have been many false allegations about the quality of those people. With the right design, the proper specification, that shipyard and the workforce are more than capable of building all the ferries that are needed for the future of the Scottish ferries.
Thank you very much indeed, and you're right in saying that the themes that you've outlined in your opening statement are ones that we will return to over the course of the next hour or so, so thank you very much for that. You'll be aware, Mr. McCall, that the Scottish Government has released quite a large number of emails which give us some sense of things that were going on from 2015 onwards. And can I take you back to August 2015?
Yes.
We've got published a correspondence from Transport Scotland to Keith Brown, who at the time was the Cabinet Secretary for Infrastructure, Investment and Cities. And on the 20th of August 2015, correspondence seeks his approval for CMAL to award shipbuilding contracts of a total cost of 96 million, I think it maybe went up to 97 million in the next few days, for two new major ferries to FML. Towards the end of this correspondence, reference is made to the potential for a legal challenge from one of the unsuccessful shipyards. And it goes on to state that CMAL was confident it could defend any challenges under those circumstances. But it said, interesting phrase, it said, that said, the relationship between Scottish ministers and Ferguson's owner is well known. So for the benefit of the committee, can you define the terms of that relationship at that time?
Yes, well, I was on a number of entities that, you know, non-paying organisations, welfare to work, and I, you know, get involved in campaigns to get people into work, working with Skills Development Scotland and so on. So I had a lot of interaction with the government, and whenever there was any issues come up with businesses that were in trouble, I always got a phone call from Alex Salmond to say, you know, would you have a look at that? Would you be interested in having a look? Now, everything I had a look at, I did have a look, and I said no. I saw my role as a businessman to be to support whoever is in power and do my best to support the government, and that's the relationship that I had with the government. When he came and asked about the shipyard, that was one that we had a further look at, did diligence on, and decided to go ahead with. So that was the relationship. It was very much a working relationship. And just for the record, I have never given money to any political party. I try not to be a supporter. I did support the idea at the time of more powers for Scotland, really, and I thought through the independence referendum last time that might result in more powers being given to Scotland. That was the main reason for backing that. But other than that, there was no closer relationship. Although, you know, there were lots of photo opportunities taken at the time, and because of events that I was involved in, I was also in the Council of Economic Advisers, along with a number of other people.
Okay, thank you. I mean, you said in your evidence to the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee that, and this is a bit later on, but you raised your concerns with the First Minister, the Cabinet Secretary for Finance, Economy and Fair Work, the Deputy First Minister, the Minister for Business, Fair Work and Skills, plus all three transport ministers. And I think you said it with an air of frustration, but you clearly had a very close relationship to a range of government ministers.
Yes, and I think it's because of the various bodies that I was on, you know, the Advisory Council, the Council of Economic Advisers, I'm on the Energy Committee, you know, there were others that I was on. And through those, I had, you know, I was fortunate to be able to have access to the ministers. But in this case, I think in what was happening in the yard, I felt it had to be raised to a high level in the government because of some of the frustrations that were going on and the costs and delays that I could see rolling up. And you know, I first flagged this up 5 years ago. And, you know, I was fortunate to be able to have access to them, you know, because of my relationship through various organisations.
Okay, but so do you think you had preferential access to them?
Oh, no. I mean, you only need to look at the history to see that I didn't. I didn't have preference. I know many businessmen and not just business people, but, you know, university principals and so on that had the same type of access because the government tended to talk to a lot of people to get input.
Okay, well, and obviously there is a financial relationship between the government, CMAL, and the company that you were the owner of. Can I again go back, though, to August 2015? Because I mentioned that email that was sent to Keith Brown on the 20th of August. Come the 31st of August 2015, the First Minister comes to the yard to announce that FML is the preferred bidder.
Yes.
For the contract. I mean, that must have strengthened your hand in any negotiations that were taking place, didn't it?
Well, It didn't, because, you know, having been named as the preferred bidder, you would normally expect, and we expected, the order to be signed by September. We didn't sign the order until the 16th of October, because we were holding out for some changes that we wanted to the contract. It wasn't acceptable to us in the form that we had seen it.
But from a negotiating position, the First Minister, the head of the government, the leader of the SNP, comes along and announces Ferguson Marine as the preferred bidder.
Yes.
I mean, she would have been made to look pretty foolish, wouldn't she, if 5.5 weeks later it was decided to put the contract back out to tender. So that must have strengthened any negotiations you were having with CMAL about the builder's refund guarantee.
Well, we'd already agreed that before she announced it.
You'd agreed the builder's refund guarantee?
Yes.
And what was the agreement?
The agreement was that, I think the final agreement was that we would put up a cash deposit of 25 million initially, and then all materials and all work, the ownership of everything that went into the vessels would be the property of CMAL. So we had no work in progress, we had no value in all the work that we did or equipment we bought. It transferred to their ownership. And our argument at the time was they've got better than 100% refund guarantee because they've got everything that's going into the vessels and they've got 25 million, which is on deposit that can be called. That later was changed into a 15 million deposit and a 25 million bond, insurance bond, which in the end they didn't claim. They forfeited claiming that 25 million bond. So we put in place, and we also offered up a parent company guarantee. So we offered up an alternative to the idea of a cash refund guarantee. Now, a cash refund guarantee means that if it's a 100 million contract, you have to deposit £100 million in the bank. Cash is a cash refund guarantee. We addressed this before we really put a lot of work into the proposal, the tender. And I think you have papers that show that we did bring this up with the local MSP, or the local MP, who I think had approached the Scottish Government. I don't know who he approached in it, but the response came back from Derek Mackay saying that Stuart had raised the issue of the guarantees with him. He explained how the cash refund guarantees worked to Stuart. I have the document here that says all of that, the one from Derek Mackay, who was the Transport Minister at the time. And it says that whilst CMAL prefer to have a cash refund guarantee, they have in the past waived this for an alternative. And that gave us the green light to go ahead and put the resources in to put in the tender. Because a lot of work goes into these tenders. And, you know, we weren't going to go ahead and do all of this if we weren't going to be allowed to negotiate some different form of guarantee. Now, I'll tell you why we can't do it, and many companies in the UK can't do this against foreign competition, because in Germany, the National Investment Bank put up the bonds for Flensburg, the shipyard there. In Poland, they get backed. In Finland and in Holland, in most European countries, it's not a burden on the company that's placing the order, that's receiving the order. The government stand behind it. And I asked, my first approach to the government was, can you stand behind this bond as they do overseas? And they said, no, because we are the buyer as well. There's a conflict there. So we had lots of discussion about how we might be able to do this. And we put forward various options, and they're on record. And they were agreed before the First Minister announced that we were the preferred bidder.
But that appears to be at odds with the email correspondence, which has fairly recently come to light on the 8th and 9th of October, where there were serious misgivings expressed by the board of CMAL about the award of the contract without a builder's refund guarantee.
Well, I can only show you what we have. We've got evidence. We've got emails showing that what was offered to CMAL and what they accepted.
And this is by the 31st of August 2015?
Oh, yes. Uh-huh.
Okay. You mentioned there about a parent company guarantee, and that's been the subject of some interest as well, because some people said that they had the impression that Clyde Blowers would kind of underwrite the work. And then I think you've later said, no, that was never the case.
No, that was never the case.
So what do you mean then by a parent company guarantee?
Well, there was a parent company at the top of Ferguson. You know, there was a holdings company, and we said we would stand behind that, but we weren't giving a Clyde Blowers guarantee. We have a number of companies that were invested in. If we gave guarantees for everyone, you know, we too would have to be able to have the backing to come through with that. We couldn't just put up a guarantee if we didn't have the wherewithal to meet it. And again, it's £100 million. Mm-hmm. No one in their right mind is going to put up a guarantee like that.
Okay, well,
That's why foreign competitors get the backing of a mechanism that's in place by their governments.
Okay. Well, I want to move us on to another area. And you said in your opening statement, Mr. McCall, about why you felt the contract has gone in the way that it has. I mean, again, if I take you to the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee's inquiry,
yes.
One of the conclusions that they made was that, and I'll quote them, FML lacked the appropriate level of design capabilities, failed to manage the design process effectively, and proceeded to build the vessels before the design had been suitably developed and signed off. How do you respond to that conclusion?
Well, it's not something I recognise, and it's not something that the government's appointed expert recognises. In fact, he's on record.
This is Mr. Van Beek.
Yes, he's on record. I mean, all you need to do is read Van Beek's evidence to the RECC, and he will tell you that what he saw was quite different to what CMAL was saying. And he also says in here that it appears that what was reported was that was just what CMAL was saying. I don't know if you're aware of Mr. Van Beek's background, but he's a serious expert in this, and the only person that's been involved that knows really in detail technically what he was talking about. You know, he's an ex-Royal Navy procurement expert, worked in defence procurement for a long time. And he was the person that worked on the two aircraft carriers. He was brought in because they were running over. And in 2 years, he saved them £800 million. He's got fabulous credentials, and he's overseen the build of a lot of these naval vessels. He has backed our story all the way through. And if you read what he has to say about CMAL...
Yes, I've read it, Mr. McCall. I've read it in the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee minutes.
Why is no one paying attention to it?
Well, I think they are. I mean, but what we're also paying attention to are the outcomes here. And here we are all this time later, and there are still no ferries. So yeah. So this guy may have been the world expert on naval procurement, ferry procurement. But the fact of the matter remains, this contract is 2.5 times over budget and 5
and
years late.
That's because he wasn't heeded in what the advice he gave. He gave advice that wasn't taken. It was ignored. And he tried to engage with CMAL. He says it all the way through. They blocked him. They wouldn't listen to him. They wouldn't engage in any of the dispute resolution. Many people have had a go at this with them. Hamza Yousaf, when he was Transport Minister, put out a paper, an email, which I've got, suggesting that they have a peer review with us, Clyde Blowers, Ferguson, CMAL and CalMac. We accepted it, CMAL didn't. Transport Scotland then proposed, and I've got the proposal from them, an expert determination process, again, blocked by CMAL. Every time some way was brought up to bring in experts to look at this, it was blocked by CMAL. Now, why they're allowed to do that, I don't know. But ministers have tried.
Can I just stop you there, Mr. McCall? Because you've said, I think, in your evidence to the Rural Economy Committee and in the written submission that you've given us, that you were concerned about the relationship between the Scottish Government and CMAL.
Yes.
And you said, we could not understand why the government did not take a stronger stance with CMAL.
Yep.
We now know why. What do you mean by that?
Well, I think what came out, which I wasn't aware of at the time, what came out of the Audit Scotland report was the evidence that came out about the chairman of CMAL's quite strong opposition to Ferguson getting the job. We didn't know that at the time, that there was strong opposition from CMAL. We wouldn't have taken that job if we'd known how strong the opposition was to get us getting it. And it looked as if they had been pushed into accepting Ferguson. That's what it looked like to me with the benefit of seeing the evidence coming out. So that's why I said, I think we know that there was something that he was forced to do that he didn't want to do, and he's put it in writing. But I think there's more. I think there's more that he has against some members of the government, because...
Where's your evidence for that?
Well, it's just circumstances. My evidence is that at every turn, when there would be, you know, it would be the natural thing to have a dispute resolution process, that would be normal commercial practice. It was blocked by CMAL. Now, if I was in a situation like this with one of the companies I owned, I would tell them, we're having an independent expert determination here. Now, it's not me that's saying, you know, I would say that we were right and they were wrong. But we brought in early on a company called BCTQ, experts in naval architecture, to give us, Clyde Blowers, comfort that what FMEL were telling us was accurate. They wrote quite a damning report, and we've submitted that. And we also have... Now, we commissioned that, so you can say... They would say it, wouldn't they? But these are professionals. They're not going to write a story that I want them to write. They're professional people. HKA are the same. They wrote the same. And then we had Luke Van Beek, who was independent from all of this, confirming what they were all saying. So that's my... You know, the evidence was all there, but no action was taken.
Okay, I'm going to move on and ask Willie Coffey to ask a couple of questions that he's got at this stage and bring other people in if they want to come in.
Willie, yeah. Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, Mr. McCall. Just to begin by following on from the Convener's question there about the Rural Economy Committee's report about the appropriate level of design capabilities and so on and so forth. Now, clearly you can test that finding. Did you get the opportunity to give evidence to the committee, and subsequently when you saw the report, were you able to challenge those findings and set that out in detail?
Yes, I was able to give evidence to the committee, and the senior management team of FMEL and myself submitted a report to them after it was printed, highlighting some of the inconsistencies in what was put forward. Now, and we said in the front there, whilst we acknowledge many of the conclusions in the report, we are concerned that most significantly, important issues have either not been addressed, are factually inaccurate, or have been presented in a way that is grossly misleading. And we've detailed them all in here. We said what was in the report and what our counter to it is. And we have evidence to back up what we've said. That's all in there and can be checked, can be fact-checked.
Yeah, thank you very much for that comment. So there's clearly a disagreement with the committee's findings in its report, that you've made that pretty clear. But in the Auditor General's report that we have, there's an issue about cables in the vessel being too short. The turnaround director, when he was appointed, unearthed this issue. And I want to ask you for your views on that. It says, can I just share this with you? The process identified that some of the 1,400 cables that FMEL had installed at the end of 2018 were too short to reach the required equipment. What do you say to that? How could that possibly come about if design and construction was proceeding correctly?
I know exactly how it came about. It's part four of what I said about the way that this was managed when the yard was nationalised. When the yard was nationalised, they put in Tim here on the day that it was. In fact, on the day that it went into administration, Tim Hare was managing it on behalf of the government. He immediately dismissed most of the senior management team and many of the key managers below that level left. They were wiped out. They had to sign NDAs, which is why I've not got more people with me today, because they are gagged and they can't get freedom from that, so they can't speak. But they were wiped out, and those were the people who were intimately involved with every part of the ship construction. We also had a very effective management system in there, and we have evidence of Lloyds, CMAL, CalMac, BAE systems giving us marks that are excellent for the systems we have. We've got evidence of it. But we were told that Tim here did was he wiped out all the systems we had, because there was no big enterprise planning system, integrated enterprise planning. Each individual there had their element of the plan, the system that they ran. There were meetings twice a day in what we called a war room, where everyone was together and they updated every aspect of the progress in that ship on a day-by-day basis. That was wiped out, all of those systems. I'm told there was no planning meeting held for 6 months after Tim Hare went in. He also sacked the design consultants that we had engaged, called Vera Navis, who were working in all the design work in the background supporting our design team. So what was wiped out was all the people that knew what was going on, all the systems that controlled it, and the design people that were behind it. There was a black hole there, and for 6 months, nobody knew what was going on in that yard. They then brought in a new design team, and I think it's been changed twice since then. The design team had nothing to go on, so they have to go into the ships and say, what do we have here, and start building it up from where it is. What's the next thing we should do? Okay. We know that they have moved control panels, they have moved pumps, they have moved equipment. If you move them and there was a cable already in place to go to them, it might not reach where they've been moved to, and that's what's happened. That's the fact. Those are the facts of what's happened. And you notice that Tim here left this until, what was it, a week before he left to announce that this problem. These cables were installed by Kongsberg earlier on. They are a very professional outfit. They had the design and install contract to put those cables in based on the design we had for where equipment was and where the control panels were, and that's what they did. These are not people that make those kind of mistakes.
So, for the avoidance of doubt, you're saying that the cables that were installed, they weren't short. It was because equipment and
they were short, right, from where they moved equipment to. But, you know, this is the crux of something that's been happening all along. Design changes. Read what Van Beek said when he was in and he was observing. He tried to freeze the changes. He said the level of changes he couldn't, you know, he's never seen before. So if you keep making changes and moving things, then it has consequences on stuff that's already been done before. And that's continued to happen. Now, you will read now of lots of, in fact, since the government took over, remedial work. That's not all remedial work. What you get, you're allowed in these contracts, is owner observations. Now, an owner observation is the owner, IEC Mal, coming back and saying, we would like to change that. Now, probably 70% of what they asked, we said no, because it wasn't something that was necessary. We were designing the vessel and we knocked it back. They're now getting a free hand in the yard to make all the changes, the nice-to-have things that they want and the changes they want to make, and they're being called remedial work. They're not remedial work. If it was properly managed, you would assess whether it should be done. Is it a necessity or is it a nice-to-have? You know, does it have an impact on other things that you've already done? You would examine all that. And we did that in the past, and there'll be a record of how many owner's observations they were called at that time. They're now called remedial work. So that's the crux of the problem, is the constant changes, and they're still happening.
Mm-hmm. Just let me finish this, if I may, Mr. McCall. So what you said quite clearly is that the cables weren't short. It was because equipment had been moved around that caused the cables to therefore not be able to reach that equipment because it had all been moved.
They weren't short for the design and the placing that we had for the control panels and other equipment. We know there's equipment being moved about. We know control panels have been moved.
Okay. Right. And on the issue about the observation reports that you mentioned yourself, there, the information we have, there was about 346 of these, and 180 were carried out, and 166 were either rejected or still outstanding. Does that fall within, you know, normal quality management procedures where a customer requests a change and the person delivering the contract discusses and agrees that changes can be carried out? So is that where the dispute resolution issue fell as well?
Well, I think...
Was there a failure to agree about changes, or was there just rejected change requests? Or how did that work?
Well, we would, if we get a request, we would review the request and see whether it was something that affected the performance of the ship, was a safety issue or whatever, and then we would decide whether to reject it or accept it. So the number of
and was that process agreed in advance? Like, because it's, if you build anything, it doesn't matter what it is, you're bound to get change requests as you go along.
Yes.
Bound to do that.
And you can.
Was there an agreement about how to approach that particular issue? Because it's at the
heart
of any...
There is a process that we put it up. They put up the request, we look at it and we say no to some and we accept others.
You know, that's at the heart of any quality control, management process. But the Auditor General's report also said there weren't any quality processes in place to manage these kinds of issues.
And where do you think he got that?
What?
I mean, we've got evidence here of people that have done audits, including CMAL, okay, giving us 97 out of 100% for excellent, and that's the term that's used in the form that they fill in for our
about,
procedures and
I'm
so on.
Talking about quality processes in place that give an agreed framework between a client and a contractor,
yes,
about what to do and how to resolve issues.
We had all of that in place. We were audited by the British, the people that were looking at the British shipbuilding strategy. Sir John Parker did a review of the shipyards in the UK, and we got a glowing report, and they went into all the control processes we had, and we got to the stage where we were nominated as a consortium partner with Babcock, and indeed had started work on agreeing with Babcock the elements of the hull that we would build. The company was nationalised before. I think it was just weeks after that it was announced that Babcock had won that, the Babcock consortium and i.e. Ferguson, but that's all gone. But we were heavily audited for all of that. We didn't get through these audits by having the type of systems that you're reading about in that report.
Okay, my final question then, convener, on this. There's also a comment in the Rural Economies report that there was evidence that the contractor deliberately proceeded to construct specific sections of the vessel either out of sequence or not according to the proper specification.
Uh-huh.
Now, what's your response to that, and how does that fit within a quality
process? Well, it's again back to the same basic problems, the four problems that I've said, but, you know, the first ones. Now, when we got the order to start on this, we expected to go in and start the construction, you know, start work on the vessels. Now, we got the order signed in October 16th. By April 2016, CMAL had to concede that the specified deadweight capacity could not be met without a change to the draft of the vessels. Now, it's a key part of the spec. They tell you the deadweight, i.e. the cargo you have to carry, the number of people, and the draft, because, you know, you need to have the right draft to get into the ports that it's going to. That had to be changed, and it took 6 months to get to the decision on how that should be changed. That should be nailed down in the spec. That work should be done before the order is placed, and it should be done by the buyer in their tender before they place the order in their tender document. So that was 6 months after contract award and 20% into the contract period. They also did not select an engine until the 27th of April 2016, 6 months in. The engine selection, again, was made 20% into the contract period. Now, once they had decided on an engine, Ferguson then have to progress with the detailed propeller design, because that's dependent on the engine. And then you have to construct a model and carry out tank tests. Prove that it works. Now, CMAL then decided they were considering two different propellers. Now, they started off in the spec as two identical ships. And they said, we want you to look at two different propeller designs. Now, that was done by Wärtsilä, who are the engine supplier that was specified by CMAL. Now, if you're specifying an engine supplier, you should have gone through what you're looking for with them. We had no option but to go to Wärtsilä, and they were the right people to go to. But you would normally have all of that bedded down before you issue the order. You know it's Wärtsilä engines you're getting. You know they are the specialists in the design of the propellers as well, because it's all the same system. So they wanted two instead of one, the same in both. And that rather belied the concept that hulls 801 and 802 were to be identical. This propeller specification was of fundamental importance, and until it was selected by CMAL, the final lines of the hull could not be designed. And the two most important ones would be the sternmost block, which is block number one, and then the block at the very front of the bow of the ship. Now, once the sternmost block...
You're going into a great deal of detail here, and if I think it might be more...
Can I summarise it then? Because I'm trying to... This was not... Before we could start with block one, which is the last one, we were 50%. It was April 2017, and we were 50% through the time of the project. That's why we started to build the blocks in the middle, where we had the design nailed down. They were signed off by Lloyds, so we weren't taking any risks, and they were not, the whole design wasn't signed off by CMAL, because again you'll see in the report by Luke Van Beek that they delayed on signing off on anything. They wouldn't agree to sign off anything. So it was a delay in the signing off rather than the approval by Lloyds. So we started to build the middle blocks. And just one more point in this. There's no sequence. There's no prescribed sequence for how the shipyard builds it. They can build it in whatever sequence they want. There's no rule. So we built the sections that we... It was out of the sequence that we wanted to build, because we wanted to build two ships side by side on the slipway, starting with the sternmost blocks and building them out, so you can always get the equipment passed until you've got the last block on.
Okay.
We couldn't do that. And so they weren't built, they were built out of our plan sequence, which contributed to the delays, but it allowed us to continue with work and minimise the delay. Because we're already 50% through the life of it.
Look, I'd like to just thank you for all of that detail. These are issues that the committee has been trying to get some feedback on, and your input today on the record is helping.
And I'm sorry it's taken so long, Mr. Coffey, for me to get it out, but I think it's important to understand why it was done the way it was done.
That's why we asked you the question. Thank you very much, and back to you.
Yeah, thank you. And if there are any points, Mr. McCall, that you want to... address in writing to us after the committee, then please, don't hesitate to do that. We welcome further written submissions as well. And for those interested in that whole thing about the landscape of the yard and how it works, I would point people as well to the evidence that Alec Logan gave on the 22nd of January 2020 to the Rural Economy Committee. He's the GMB convener at the yard. Sharon Dowie's got some questions to put to you.
Thank you very much. Good morning.
Morning.
Can I ask why CBC purchased the shipyard in 2014? You mentioned earlier on in the evidence to Richard about Alex Salmond phoning you if businesses were in difficulty. So it was to ask if you had any discussions with the Scottish Government or Scottish ministers prior to purchasing the shipyard, and if so, what the nature of the discussions were?
Well, obviously we met with Alec Salmond and John Swinney, I think it was at the time, who were pushing us to have a look at it and see if we could come up with a plan to save it. So we had discussions with them, but those are the only people that we had discussions with, and it was their initiative in approaching us to see if we would have a look at the yard.
And was that the extent of the discussions? Just have a look?
They were quite aggressive in, look, we need to get something done here if you're going to do it. So we went ahead, we had some market studies done, what's the opportunity? We did diligence, and we decided that there was a great opportunity here, and that we would negotiate with the administrator at the time, that was KPMG, I think, at the time. And we negotiated with the administrator, and we did have contact from time to time from Alex when Alec or John to just see where we progressing. It was just to check, you know, or is there anything else you need? And we didn't. We just wanted to get on and complete our diligence.
So was there any incentives from the Scottish Government or from ministers for you to buy the company?
No, there was no incentives, but I did have a request from them, which I put once we'd finished our diligence. I found out that the ship had placed, they had responded to a bid for four hybrid ferries. They were all similar. Two of them had already been built, and I did ask them, were they intending to build the remaining two? And they said that they were intending to build one more, but they hadn't committed to another two. And I said, well, I want the right to that order. You know, it was a bid that was put in by Ferguson, so I wanted the ownership of that bid in what we bought, because we'd been through European, the yard had been through the European regulations, you know, procurement regulations, and Ferguson had been awarded the order for four, although only two had been released by the Scottish Government. So I wanted to be assured that that order would be honoured if they were placing the order for the third one. So that was the only thing that I insisted on to start the, you know, to complete the deal. Now, that ferry was built. We agreed to do it at cost. Because we, you know, were just getting into the yard. It was built on budget and delivered six weeks early.
So that contract went ahead?
Yes, that went ahead. We eventually got that. We built the ship and we launched it, and I'm told it's operating very effectively now and it's of good quality. So
that's fine. And can I ask, you've mentioned earlier on about FMail's inability to provide the full refund guarantee, and that was in the invitation to tender. So can I ask why you've done the bid for the contract for 801 and 802 when that was in the invitation to tender, saying that you had to provide a BRG?
As I said to you, we approached the local MP...
MSP,
the local MSP.
Who was the local MSP?
Sorry?
Who was the local
MP?
No,
I think it's the local MP, is he not? Stuart.
The local MSP is Stuart McMillan.
That's it, that's Stuart right. McMillan. That's who he came along to the yard and said, look, we've got the chance to bid for these two, but we can't, because we can't put up a cash refund guarantee. He took it up with the Scottish Government. Now, I'm not quite sure who he took it up with, but it's in the email that came back. The email came back from Derek Mackay, saying, effectively giving us the green light that you don't necessarily need to put up a cash refund guarantee, that something else can be negotiated. That's the message we got back. I don't know if you've got that email from Derek Mackay, but if I'm quite happy to give you a copy of it.
No.
And that was done well before we submitted the tender, because we weren't going to put all the work in if we were going to have to put up a cash refund guarantee.
So you had confirmation that you didn't need to supply the BRG before you put your bid in?
Well, we had made it quite clear all along, and we had confirmation in the terms of that email that an alternative would be acceptable.
Right, because I know that in the audit they had said that because you had mentioned it in your bid, it was assumed that you could provide a BRG, and it wasn't until they got to the negotiation stage that that they realised? So at what point did CMAL or Transport Scotland know? Was it just the Minister at that time or Stuart McMillan?
No. We were working with CMAL all the way through the bidding process. So they knew all the way through the bidding process.
Right, so they were aware of it?
Yes.
Before it was announced that you had the contract?
Absolutely.
Right, OK. Just another question was in the spec, and you mentioned that with Willie Coffey. Was the spec issued by CMAL at the start of the contract adequate then? No.
No, I mean you will see that there are comments from, well, BCTQ, HKE, but more importantly, because of his independence, Commodore Luke Van Beek, that the spec fell way short of what you would expect to see in a specification. And that what happened is after it was issued, they started then to change, to ask things like, I've gone through the draft change, the dead weight change, you know, the dead weight, the draft, the engines, the propellers, you know, all of these things were developed after they issued the order.
So the invitation to tender then, the specification from CMAL was not adequate for any of the people that were
putting in bids? No, absolutely. And that's been confirmed by three lots of professionals, experts. And there's no experts that are countering that.
Right.
I don't class Tim Hare as an expert, and I don't class Kevin Hobbs as an expert because they don't have a background in naval architecture. You really need to understand the technicalities here.
Right. Well, had you not taken the contract for the two vessels, did you have enough work at the yard to make it viable? Like, would you have survived if you hadn't taken that contract?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I could show you lists of orders that we had, and we were also working on. And I can give you in a list of those if you don't have them. But we had plenty of work out there. What we had done from day one was look to diversify away from dependence just on Scottish ferries, because we knew that that could be bumpy. You know, they might not place an order, they might not have the funding for it. So we had a whole load of activities going on, and we had a lot of other work. We had some fabrication work. We had a squad that went out to different yards and did repairs on different yards down south. So we had quite a bit of work going on, and we were also still working on Katrina, the small ferry that I mentioned earlier on. So there was plenty going on in the yard, and at that time there's probably about 130 people employed. So, you know, it was an exciting future. And, you know, I don't know if you've got the evidence, but we have an investment paper that was prepared and approved to put a further 8.7 million into the yard. That was approved 1 month before we knew we were the preferred bidder. So would we go ahead with investing 8.7 million in it if it was totally reliant on that order? We wouldn't. We would have waited to see if we got it. So that's just absolute nonsense that this anything negative would have happened to this yard if it didn't get the order. I wish we hadn't got it, because we'd be flying high just now with a whole load of different orders, including the Type 31 destroyers working with Babcock.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, we are rapidly running out of time, but I know that there are substantive questions that both Craig Hoy and Colin Beattie want to ask, and so I'm going to turn first of all to Colin.
Thank you, Peter. Mr. McCall, my main interest in this is obviously following the public pound. There's a lot of money being invested into this, a lot of public money, and I'm keen to understand how it's been dealt with. Now, at the point of nationalisation, the vessels were basically largely incomplete.
Yes.
£128.25 million of public money was invested into the yard and into the construction of those ships. How was that money spent?
It was on the ships. What happened is...
But that's not evidenced by the value at point of nationalisation.
Yes, it is. Every penny that was forwarded went into those ships. It went into the ships and the ownership transferred to CMAL. What was causing additional costs and additional things to happen is some of the issues that I've mentioned to you, changes. So there were further costs and there were delays. If you've got a 6 month delay, that's 6 months more of a workforce that you've built up to do it. So there are costs. The costs were running way ahead, but all of those costs were in those ships. All of it went into those ships. That had to be signed off by Luke Van Beek and PwC. This is all well controlled. And that money went into the ships.
Is there any document that, obviously you're saying that the money was absorbed by changes and so on to the specifications. Is there any document that lays that out and puts cost against that?
Well, PwC audited what costs had gone in and advised the government on what further costs would have to go in. And that's the work that was required to build those ships. They weren't going to be built for 97 million. You know, these were a first of their type in the UK. They hadn't been done before in the UK. Lloyd's had no processes for it. They were building their processes for LNG ships as they went. And these were prototypes that were costing more to build than was in the budget. And it was variations and delays that caused it. Variations to what was asked for and delays.
How does this committee identify those and understand what the costs are that are against them?
Because they've all been audited. They ask for the PwC audits, look at the accounts of the invoices that are there, the time spent by people on them is there. That's what it went to. It's actually self-evident that that's what it cost. And, the 45 that went in, 15 and then 30, very strictly controlled. On before it was released, PwC and Luke Van Beek had to sign off and say, yes, that work was done and that's what it cost. So it's well documented and controlled by the government.
So you're saying the government's got this information?
Yeah, well, it was well controlled. It's all there, and it was all in the records of the company.
I mean, I think what I'm saying is, from the point of view of this committee, we can only look at evidence we receive that we're able to.
Well, the money came in and it went to build these ships. There was either, it went into the ships. Is there anywhere else there was leakage that where it went? Have you got any suggestions as to where it might have gone? Because,
well, we don't know. I mean,
no,
we're
because
not experts in this.
We're trying to find evidence. We did our monthly management accounts. You know, we've got graphs of PwC worked on it quite a bit, and they've got graphs of the costs, and they've got graphs of the cash that was coming in, and there was a big gap. This was all well monitored all the way through.
Let me turn to one specific area, which is these milestone payments, which totaled about 83.25 million. Now, I'm looking at the report from the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee back in December 2020, and they say here there's in paragraph 160, there's strong evidence that the contractor deliberately proceeded to construct specific sections of the vessel either out of sequence or not according to the proper specification, purely as a means of triggering milestone payments on the contract. And again, paragraph 157, the contractor progressing certain work on the vessels either incorrectly or out of sequence, purely in order to trigger payments against the contract.
Well,
and Commodore Luke van Beek also gave evidence to the committee that Ferguson's deliberately slowed down some of the subcontracting. So I'm trying to understand. I mean, I'm a layman in this. I don't understand the naval contracts, but it seems to me that if the work, if milestones are at sort of A, B, and C, and the work between A and B has not been carried out, and just the work at that milestone to trigger a payment is being done, that doesn't seem to me to be right.
No, it's a misunderstanding. Maybe I can explain. The milestones were based on the fabrication. That was one of the big milestones, percentage of fabrication. I told you that there was no prescribed sequence. So to say, for the committee to say that it was done out of sequence is not... It's not an accurate comment, because there is no sequence. What we had to do, because of what I went over about the delay on the engines, the propellers, the draft, what we had to do was build sections that were not the sections that we intended to start with and not in the sequence that we intended. But that was our choice, and that was our decision, and it was up to us how we built that. The idea was to keep the work going and keep people employed and do as much as we could with the information that we had, and we had approved by Lloyds. And that's why we built the centre sections. That triggered milestone payments in the fabrication, because we had done the fabrication and they were legally obliged to pay us for what had been done. So there's nothing, you know, there's no skullduggery here or manipulating what should have been done to trigger anything. And I think it's insulting to insinuate that we would do that. Well, if you look at how the milestones were laid out, it was on percentage of fabrication. And we were doing the percentage of fabrication in a different order from we initially intended, but it was valid. And it was for a very good reason, to keep the work going and the project progressing. Otherwise, we would have had people sitting about twiddling their thumbs, and we would have had a big delay until we got this information sorted out.
Well, I think this committee really needs to understand that, because, you know, we look at what the previous committee produced, and they seem to be looking at this from the point of view that it's something extraordinary, the way the milestone payments have been done, and the fact that they're out of sequence and so forth. That implies to me what I'm reading here, just what I said, which is, did that work between A and B take place to allow the milestone at B to be triggered?
No, it wasn't a case of if you do all of these blocks, it'll trigger it, and we did the last one to trigger it. It was on percentage of fabrication, on certain items of equipment being bought. You know, so there was evidence that we'd bought the equipment, and it triggered if there were big payments for engines and, you know, big items, there would be a payment that you could call once you had bought that. And when we bought it, it went into CMAL's ownership. So that triggered payments. It was a payment to us to buy them, but immediately it was transferred to CMAL. So there was no triggering of payments, you know, to give us more money. Whatever it triggered went to CMAL, and it was equipment that was bought, and it was percentage of fabrication. And our job as the management, or the management team's job, was to keep as much as we could on programme by fabricating what we had cleared with Lloyds at the time, and not stand about waiting on decisions to be made that should have been made earlier, before the specification was given out.
You see, there are certain statements in the previous report that seem to raise a question. For example, in paragraph 157, they state that the profile of milestone payments may have resulted in the contractor progressing certain work on the vessels either incorrectly or out of sequence, purely in order to trigger payments against the contract.
Well, I can't, you know, I don't know what I need to do to get this over, and it's really important that the committee get this. The trigger, the payments were triggered by equipment being purchased or percentage of fabrication. If we are fabricating centre sections of the ship because we have them all cleared and we've got Lloyd signed off on them, that's valid to do and it's the right thing to do. I don't know how I can make that clearer. That's the absolute factual truth. That's how it was set up. In fact, Luke Van Beek had also made the comment in his submission to the committee that he thought the payments were wrongly put in place because they didn't match the cash outflow. And there was a mistake in the way they were done. He said they should have matched the cash outflow, but it would never have matched it because there was additional work having to be done, changes being made, and it was always going to cost a lot more. What we were pushing for early on was let's have mediation to agree who's at fault here. And I wasn't expecting FMEL to get off with it. I was expecting them to be responsible for some, but for sure CMAL weren't getting off with it or shouldn't have got off with it, but they have.
So given your statement that these milestone payments were payment for large equipment and so on, for example...
And percentage of fabrication.
And percentage of fabrication. Takes us in a full circle back to the value that was actually in the yard, which
yes.
I believe was, I'm talking from memory here, so it's open to correction, something over 8 million. And yet...
Where did you get the 8 million, sorry?
I'm talking from memory, it was a valuation, I think, at point of nationalisation. Well,
that's wrong. Because the value in the yard is we'd invested 28 million in the yard. That infrastructure was all there, and that's value. Also, the ships had all the value in them that we had been paid for, plus more, because we had lost some money out of it as well. So all of that value was there. Now, if you write off the value of the ships, I don't know where that 8 million came up. That to me, is nonsense. The value in that yard when they took it over was the infrastructure and the vessels that they had. If they were going to continue with them in a going concern, which they have done. So they had a lot of equipment there that had been paid for, a lot of fabrication that had been paid for, and that value was there.
What would your estimated value be?
Of what was there?
Yeah.
Well, I think it was... I think we had called down something like 82 million at the time, and then there was the 45 million that the government had forwarded, and we'd put in a further 3 million that we lost. So if you add 45, 3, 48 onto the 82, that's what I think. You mentioned the number of 130 odd. I think that's what was in it.
25, yeah. Now, FMIL accepted 45 million from the Scottish Government, but it said it didn't want the loans.
No.
So why did you accept them?
Because all the way through, and I've got evidence that that suggests that the government were working, or the government were working with us all the way through towards a dispute resolution process. So the government were very keen to make sure, and I've got internal emails and emails to the government saying we are going to have, unless we can get a resolution, a dispute resolution that draws a line under who's responsible for what, we can't continue paying 250 people in the yard or however many were there, plus all the subcontractors. And you mentioned earlier about us delaying, slowing down subcontractors. We had to. We didn't have the money to pay them. And they wouldn't, you can't invite people in and then not be able to pay them. And that's why there was a lot of urgency on trying to get a dispute resolution. And that needed independent expert determination. And that was pushed by Transport Scotland, but was refused by the chairman of CMAL. He said their board had taken a decision that they were not going to enter into independent expert determination. Now, my question is, if they were so sure of their position, why would they be afraid to enter into an independent expert? They've not wanted an expert to get near this, and they wouldn't speak to Van Beek. In fact, they were quite belligerent with him in his evidence that he gave to the committee that they just wouldn't talk to him. And this is what we've had all the way through. And this is where I think this committee needs to realise that to get to the bottom of the very valid questions you're asking, you need to have independent technical experts look at it as well. They've never been involved. Never been involved. The only one is Luke Van Beek. And I would urge you to read again his whole narrative, the submission that he made to the RECC. Read it closely.
Obviously, the dispute between FMEL and CMAL was very significant. At any point, was FMEL advised by the CMAL board that they would resign if there was any intervention in the dispute? And if so, who advised that?
No, that was a story. Again, trying to push the independent expert determination, I went to meet with Derek Mackay, who at that time was the finance secretary, and I met him in Holyrood, and I was begging him to insist, to force CMAL to accept an independent expert determination, because if he didn't, this was going to get out of hand, and it needed to be brought to a head. He asked the officials in the room to leave, and he told me that he couldn't force them to do it because they had sent a legal letter, he said, to government ministers threatening that if they interfered with them as an independent board, or if they continued to interfere with them as an independent board, they would resign en masse and say why. Now, that's why when I read that the chairman of CMAL was staunchly against this at the beginning, and it looks as if he was forced into accepting placing the order with Ferguson, I took that to kind of be what Derek Mackay was referring to, you know, when he told me that. There was no one else in the room, so no one else can corroborate it, but perhaps the officials that were there at the meeting can tell you they were asked to leave and leave me in the room.
So why didn't FMEL ever pursue its claim in court?
Pardon?
Why didn't FMEL ever pursue its claim in court?
Because that is all along we were being led to believe that we were going to have a dispute resolution, and the government were working with CMAL to try and get that, with both of us, to try and get that to happen. Every time it was put up, they were told by CMAL no. They were also told by Luke Van Beek at the end, have arbitration, don't nationalise this yard because your costs are going to escalate. This is the cheapest way to do it. And he has also, in his evidence, advised them that they should deal direct with CMAL, CalMAC, and cut out CMAL and get some independent expert in to get this sorted out. He was so frustrated with CMAL that he recommended cutting them out. You know, you need to understand the technical things that went wrong here that are not of FMEL's making.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to turn to Craig Hoy, but just on that last point, you know, you've said in your written evidence that Mr. Mackay said he'd got a legal letter.
Yes. What
do you understand by that terminology? What is a legal letter?
I don't know whether it... Well, every time you challenged CMAL, they immediately threatened legal action. I know they even turned up to the RECC with the lawyers, and they had been told, the lawyers were told to leave. That's the type of people they were, you know. So, and the reason that we did not go for it, we were being told by the government that there was going to be a resolution. We were aware that it might not all be in our favour. We're aware of that, but we needed the resolution. And their solution to giving us, to keeping things going, because they were very clear they didn't want the people to be laid off, the workforce, and work to stop. They wanted it to continue. And to do that, they put in 15 million to start with. Now, when they put in the 15 million, we had 15 million of our own money on deposit. And my approach to them was, can we have our own money back to keep things going until we get to some sort of process to resolve this? And they said, we can't do that. We need to make it a commercial loan. But we saw it as a bridging loan until we got to the point where we had a dispute resolution. That's what should have happened. And that's what we were being led to believe. Then it became clear we needed more money. And again, Jerry Marshall had suggested all the people he would have to lay off, the subcontractors and everyone. And we were told, PwC was put in. They were told we needed the 30 million. And they said it would only last until a certain date. I think it was the end of June. They told the government how long it would last before they would need to put in more money. Now, they were able to say that because they were analysing the costs, and they knew how much it was costing to continue doing this work in these two vessels. And it's when we got to the end of that period that the whole approach from the government changed, and they shut down, and they were obviously on a plan to nationalise the yard then, because to keep putting additional loans in wasn't feasible. And we didn't want loans, we wanted a settlement, even if part of that settlement was a cost to us.
I mean, I'm going to bring Craig Hoy in, but just, I mean, on the, to go back to the point about this legal letter, I mean, this committee was told in evidence last week by Chris Wilcock, the head of the ferries unit at Transport Scotland, that his understanding from the CEO of CMAL was no such threat existed. We're going to get CMAL in a fortnight's time, so we'll put some of these questions to them.
Well, I know that Kevin Hobbs has said that in the past.
He said what? Sorry, he denies it, or he agrees?
No, he said that no such letter existed.
It. Okay.
But he wouldn't know at the time. Would he? What happened?
Well, he's the chief executive, and this is a board.
He wasn't appointed until just after this order was placed. Okay. And it's since...
But your meeting with Mr. Mackay was on the 5th of June 2018.
Yes, but he was referring to something that had happened earlier.
Who was? Derek Mackay?
Mackay, yes. He said, I can't go...
So he says 3 years ago I got a threat that people would resign.
No, he didn't say... The term, he said, we have had this letter. Now,
but I'm trying to understand this. You're saying that a legal letter, he just received a legal letter.
No, he didn't say he just
received it. On the 5th of June 2018, or this was a three-year-old legal letter.
No, he didn't say when he got one. He just referred to the fact that they had, in the past at some time, received a letter threatening them. I don't know when that happened or who it came from. I don't know. But I swear under oath that that's what he said to me. And that's why I've asked for some kind of investigation under oath, because people need to tell the truth.
We work on the basis that people before us are telling the truth.
Well, I do too.
Craig Hoy wants to come in with a number of questions. Craig.
Thank you, Convener, and welcome, Mr. McCall. You referred in your opening statement prior to that about the fact that some of your former colleagues couldn't attend because they're subject to gagging orders. I'm not sure we need to go into the names, but can you say the kind of roles to which those gagging orders applied? And at any stage, were you involved in a gagging order, and have you been released from one?
No, no. The gagging orders were issued by Tim Hare, who was working on behalf of the government as the managing agent in the yard. There were, you know, if I give you the titles, you know who the people are, yeah, no. You know. But it's fair to say that most of the senior management, you know, finance, operations, naval architecture, purchasing, supply chain, safety, you know, and there are a few of them that have suffered depression from what's happened to them, because they have been sullied and their reputation has been sullied by some of the false statements that have been made about the quality of work prior to the government taking over, and which is false. It's absolutely false. These were really good people that we recruited. We had a fabulous workforce there. There is a very strong workforce there that are high-quality, skilled people. They didn't, when they were working for us, do bad welds or bad quality work and then all of a sudden be told how to do good welds and good quality work just by people who come in.
Just on that point, the First Minister said to Parliament that if it was a government gagging order that applied to any of those individuals, that it would be lifted so they could fully participate in any inquiry. Is it your understanding that those are government-imposed gagging orders?
Of course it was government-imposed, but, you know, I know that the Audit Scotland approached the government because we gave the names, we actually gave them a copy of the gagging order so that they could see that it wasn't a normal employment contract confidentiality agreement. This was a gagging order, and Audit Scotland have that. They also had a key individual who was prepared to come up. Others won't because they are employed just now and their reputation is being damaged by false accusations about what they were involved in before, and they're worried about that damaging their current employment. I understand that.
Yeah. Okay, I'm going to go back over several of the issues that have been raised this morning. You said that you were encouraged to engage in the purchase of the yard. Were you encouraged to bid for these two vessels?
Yes, but we were wanted to. So I wouldn't say we were put under pressure to. This is something that we believed the yard could do, and I still believe we could have done it if it had been properly specced or even managed in a different way early on.
Okay. Now, the First Minister says that all the way through, the major consideration for awarding the contract to FML, and particularly when it hit troubled times, was the preservation of jobs. Can you say, hand on heart to this committee, that if the contract hadn't been awarded to FML, that there would still be jobs and a thriving yard there?
We had 135 at the time, and we had a forecast, because we'd done all the work on the Type 31 destroyers, a number of other vessels that we had bid for, and we had predicted 700 people employed in the yard by today.
So you would say the government's intervention has actually undermined jobs on the yard?
Yes.
Okay. Fine. You met with the First Minister at Bute House, where you say you raised a red flag about the project. Was this another one of these meetings where the officials were asked to leave the room?
No. No, there were officials in the room. Okay. Or one, at least one, I think.
So can you just tell us a bit about the nature of that meeting? What did
I asked for the meeting.
What did she undertake to do?
Well, I asked for the meeting. I went along and explained some of these delays, because, you know, we were now at, it was April 2017, I told you, before we could start work on Block 1, 50% through the project life, or the planned project life. I contacted the First Minister when, you know, when I realised that, you know, this is a problem. We had asked CMAL, or the management in FMEL had asked CMAL to sit down and discuss this, and they refused. They couldn't get them to discuss all these changes and the delays, and the fact that we were 50% through and we were just getting the information to start on the block one. And that's why I contacted the First Minister out of desperation to force some discussion on it. And I met with her on the 31st of May. And that was, you know, we started these blocks in April, and we'd had some meetings in the yard with the management team, and they had tried to engage with CMAL, but they were getting just blanked out. And my appeal to the First Minister was, you need to get involved, because this is going to get out of hand. We need them to engage with us. And she appointed Liz Ditchburn to oversee, or to try and get the two parties together, and to resolve the issues. Now, all through that summer and into the next year, there was no progress. It was just talking.
Just on that point. So you said that's the 31st of May 2017. In November 2017, the First Minister came to the yard to launch Glen Sannox.
Yeah.
That launch was as fake as the painted on windows, wasn't it?
It wasn't fake, no. That was a proper launch. And again, Luke Van Beek will confirm it was the right thing to do, which he did in his evidence. As I explained to you, because we couldn't build from block one up, we couldn't build both vessels side by side. So to progress with all the work we had to do in 802, we had to be able to free it up on the slipway. We had completed all the work on 801 to allow it to... The hull was watertight. There was a lot of work done in the hull. There was work that we would like to have finished on the slipway, but we could finish it on the quayside, giving us plenty of room on the slipway to accelerate work in 802. Had we not launched it, it would have impaired us working on 802. So it was the proper logistical thing to do. You can build it on the quayside. This was all work. You put the staging up, you go on the ship and you do the work on it, the same as you go up when it's on the slipway. The windows were painted by the workforce, and I think it's out of pride of them launching the ship. The windows weren't cut out because they weren't put in yet. But all they did was they paint the bits that were in the windows black. Because they don't want, you know, they want it to look as nice as it can to be launched. But that's a complete red herring. It's absolutely irrelevant to the progress of the ship.
But obviously, I mean, whose idea was it for the First Minister to come along and have a great razzmatazz photo call around this? Was that something that...
That would be the government and their PR people. We told, they knew that we were putting that in the water to make way for 802, and she wanted to come out and be part of the launch, just like she wanted to come out on the 31st of August and stand with the workforce and get her picture taken.
Yeah.
And just like they wanted the order being signed on the 16th of October, on the day of the conference, conference.
I was going to turn to that, because it strikes me that alongside all the technical issues here, there's been a political dynamic to rush this at various points for different reasons. And you said in your submission, there was clearly a great pressure on the timing of the announcement that it was going to FMEL, and there was a high probability that pressure was also on CMAL to rush the invitation to tender. So has there been a political driving force throughout this as well?
Do you think? That's the impression I have, that because when I look back at all the evidence that came out, and then I look at events that happened and, you know, the timing of them, and also Luke Van Beek also had given evidence to the RACC that this tender had been placed before doing sufficient work to put it out.
Yeah.
Now, why would they do that? Why would they put it out quickly? And you know, we did hear in some of the evidence from Audit Scotland that the chairman of CMAL wanted to re-tender it.
Yeah.
Well, they could have done that. But that wouldn't have been a good story. It wouldn't have been, the timing wouldn't have worked. Yeah.
One of the other elements where it could be implied that politics was at play was around the nationalisation of the yard. At any point did you suggest anything different that might have meant that potentially the amount of money that taxpayers have now been exposed to and the risk that taxpayers were exposed to would have somehow been shared? At any point did you say, well, actually, maybe there's wrong on both sides here, let's sit down and arbitrate for a different solution here?
Yes,
because I'm concerned, like Mr. Beattie, about the public purse here.
Yes.
And post-nationalisation, it has got significantly worse. Was there an alternative route to getting these ships?
Yes, when we got to the 11th hour and I realised we were not going to get a dispute resolution process and we didn't have enough money to finish the vessels and we were not, I mean, the government were saying, oh, you committed to put in additional money and you're not doing it. We were putting in additional money for an acquisition they were wanting to do to add on to the yard. That's what it was highlighted for. We weren't going to put money in to subsidise a government project, in our view. But I did then put in a proposal to them for a financial restructuring where we would bear, our estimate at the time, and it came out of the HKE report, was that I think the total cost would be 194 or 195 million. That was, HK had done, I didn't bring them up, but I have in my car. There are four big volumes of detailed work done by HKE, who are naval architecture experts and marine engineer experts on the whole project. They spent 4 months doing it and a lot of money put in to get them to do it. Now, they told us what we'd have to do. So I said, look, we'll bear half of the upside. So half of the additional, say, 100 million, we'll bear that. Because, you know, our view was if it was just an arbitration, then some people would just split the cake and say, you're responsible for half. And so I put forward a proposal to Derek Mackay. And I also said to protect them from going above the 195, we would bear the cost of anything above that, because that gave us an incentive to really make sure that it came in for that price. Derek Mackay came back and said that it didn't meet European rules. It breached, is it MEOP or whatever? I don't know what the term is.
State aid rules.
Yes, state aid rules. Yeah. So I went and got a QC's report, and it couldn't be clearer that there was no breach of state aid rules. He covered it in great detail, and this was a respected QC with good knowledge of state aid rules.
So just to be certain, you proposed a solution that could potentially have saved the taxpayer about £50 million here?
No, £100 million, because you're going to have to pay probably £100 million more than that. Okay.
And and the government set...
He said no, yeah. And I gave him a QC's report, and he said, well, we don't agree with it. And I then went back, and I've got the email trail back and forward to him. I said, look, I've identified a second QC in Brussels who you could go to check it, because I think we need to move forward with this and complete these ships. And he said, no, we disagree, and he wouldn't.
So you
I don't think he got independent QC's opinion. In fact, I know he didn't, because if he did, it was such a clear-cut case that it did not breach EU rules, but it was turned down.
So back to this kind of flagrant disregard for the public purse, you think they had taken the decision to nationalise in any proposal, even though it was in the better interest of the taxpayer, they weren't intent on proceeding on that basis? That was nationalisation was the only objective at that point, do you think?
Yes, and it was, because, again, there seems to have been an attempt to protect CMAL from any downside on this all the way through. Now, if we had done that, would Seamill have to pay the 194 for the ship? Because that's what it costs. It doesn't matter who's, you know, if the government would put forward half the money we did, well, they have to pay 194 million for the ship. They've said repeatedly, we're not paying a penny more than 97. And in fact, the government have actually taken the contract off them, so they've not been held to account.
Yeah.
This is a government organisation that is avoiding being held to account.
So just my last question on that. Do you think that Seamile has got something over on the government here?
Yes. I mean, they've been advised. I mean, the selection of the vessels, you know, LNG, they shouldn't have LNG vessels there. Then CalMac didn't want them. Luke Van Beek gave evidence about speaking to the chief executive at the time of CalMac, and they said they didn't want LNG. There's no bunkering arrangements in place for LNG, and it's going to cost a lot of money to put that in place. They'd have to ship tankers up from the Isle of Grain just now, and they can't do that. And they're now obsolete technology. There's a couple of papers recently, one from a Norwegian minister saying that they won't be buying any more LNG-fueled vessels, and there's an industry report out saying that the emissions from LNG vessels are 80% more toxic than a diesel fumes, and that this is they all have to be eliminated. So you're now completing two vessels that are obsolete, and you're not going to run them in LNG anyway, because the infrastructure's not there. And if you did, you're going to be putting out poisonous gases between Brodick and Ardrossan and the other routes as well. These are not green vessels. So they were wrongly spec'd. Now, the government have been advised by their ferry advisory committee, which was wound up. But before it was wound up, the two experts on it wrote a final report. And I'm sure you've seen that. If you haven't, it's worthwhile getting a hold of. Because they'll tell you that they're wrongly spec'd.
Okay, look, we are in the final few minutes that we've got left, and I think Willie Coffey, do you want to come back in? No, you're okay. Colin Beattie had a final point to make, I think, or question to ask. Colin.
Yes, please, Commissioner. I just wanted to come back in on a couple of points that we touched on earlier on. I've managed to dig out here the cost of purchasing FML's assets, which is, and I realise there's all sorts of offset figures involved in this as well, so this is a crude figure, 7.5 million. That was the valuation put on all the assets in the yard, which is very far short, of course, of the money that went in there. The second thing I was going to make a point on was the milestone payments, 83.25 million. 82.5 million were milestone payments. 0.75 million were for contract variations. And that seems a very small figure.
Yes.
Listening to what you're saying about
the changes that were made. Yeah, because CML refused to agree to any of the changes. They wouldn't sign off on them, so you can't bill them for it.
So there are large discrepancies.
Large discrepancies, yes.
Mm. Okay, thank you. The final point I'd like to put to you, Mr. McCall, is you at various times have described this contract as catastrophic.
Yep.
And you've called it a fiasco.
Yep.
Do you share any responsibility for that catastrophe?
I don't believe so, because we pushed hard. The way to do this was we tried to work early on with the CMAL people on developing the spec, although it was underdeveloped when we got it. That we tried as hard as we could. We tried very hard to get dispute resolution. We couldn't have done any more on dispute resolution. And on nationalisation, we did offer an alternative to nationalisation, and Luke Van Beek recommended that they didn't nationalise. And I don't know what else we could have done. These two ferries inherently cost more than the first, the bid that was put in. If we do share some responsibility, it's perhaps in not realising the extent to which this might overrun and the extent of the shortcomings in the spec. However, in the HKA report and the BCTQ report, they say that things were emerging that you couldn't have foreseen. So we had to deal with them as they arose. And I'm sure we have some responsibility, absolutely. But compared to the big issue here, it's very, very small.
OK, well, look, thank you very much indeed. And Mr. McCall, thank you for giving up so much of your time this morning and furnishing us with some detailed and wide-ranging answers to the questions that we had. As I mentioned earlier on, if you do, on reflection, have any other material that you think would be useful to the inquiry that we're running to help inform that, we'd be very happy to receive that.
Right.
But again, thank you once again for your time this morning.
Okay, and if there is anything else that you think of that you didn't ask, then I'm happy to you know, either come back or answer any questions.
Thank you very much indeed. And I will now close the public session of this morning's committee meeting. Thank you very much.